And the third structure will be the deep temporal nerves and vessels, which will pass deep to zygomatic arch. So these three structures are present deep to the zygomatic arch, viva question. Then we come across to the temporal fossa boundaries. For the temporal fossa boundaries, what are the boundaries of temporal fossa? We need to understand these lines. If you are able to see this, how beautifully and naturally these lines are represented. If I try and draw here, this, there are two lines which will pass from, it will start from this point. And the name of this suture will be frontozygomatic suture. So from frontozygomatic suture, from the edge, these two lines, one line, it is passing above, then it will cross this suture. Name of this suture, yesterday I had discussed with you, it is known as the coronal suture. It will cross the coronal suture, it will cross the parietal bone, parietal eminence. This is known as superior temporal line, and another line which will start along with superior temporal line, but it will be present just a few centimeters below. This is called inferior temporal line, and this inferior temporal line will curve downwards, forwards, and it will join with supramastoid crest here on this side. What about superior temporal line? It will be gradually lost in the vicinity. That is, it will be gradually lost. Now this inferior temporal line will gradually pass downwards and join the supramastoid crest. So from these lines, for example, from superior temporal line, there will be attachment of temporal fascia. Temporal fascia is attached here from the superior, on the superior temporal line. Just below the inferior temporal line, just below the superior temporal line, that is the inferior temporal line, and the space here, there will be attachment of temporalis muscle. So therefore, the temporal fascia which is attached here, it will extend down and it will be attached to the upper border of zygomatic arch. And the temporalis muscle which is attached here, this temporalis muscle which is attached at the inferior temporal line, it will also take origin from this surface. Name of this surface is temporal fossa. So temporalis muscle, number one, point of origin from inferior temporal line. Number two, point of origin from the surface of the temporal fossa. And this temporalis muscle will then pass, the fibers will be directed downwards, forwards and backwards. It will pass deep to zygomatic arch. And the insertion will be on the mandible, that will be in the next sequence of classes. So here the importance of these lines, the importance of temporal fossa, origin of temporalis fascia, and the origin of temporalis muscle. Now this much is about temporal fossa. Now what are the boundaries of temporal fossa? Of course, the boundaries of temporal fossa will be anteriorly, it is limited by zygomatic bone. Posteriorly, it is limited by posterior root of zygoma. It is called posterior root of zygoma. Laterally, it is limited by upper border of zygomatic arch. Medially, it is limited by temporal fossa. And medially also this structure will come, pterion, p-t-e-r-y-i-o-n, pterion, or in some books it is mentioned as p-t-e-r-i-o-n. This will form the medial wall. Then inferiorly, the temporal fossa is communicating with infratemporal fossa. Here what I am showing it to you is infratemporal fossa. So these are the boundaries of temporal fossa. Now we come to infratemporal fossa. This infratemporal fossa, the superior boundaries are lower border of zygomatic arch. Then more superomedially here, if you are able to see this portion, this bone, this is greater wing of sphenoid. And lower down, if you see this, this is the infratemporal crest of greater wing of sphenoid. Infratemporal surface and infratemporal crest of greater wing of sphenoid. This will form the roof portion of infratemporal fossa. Then we come down to the anterior wall. Anterior wall of infratemporal fossa is formed by this bone. Name of this bone is below the zygomatic. This bone is called maxilla. Posteriorly it will be occupied by mandible here. Head and neck and ramus of mandible. Posterior wall of infratemporal fossa. Then medially you are able to see very clearly this plate. This is lateral pterygoid plate. And you are able to appreciate beautifully this fissure between lateral pterygoid plate and body of maxilla. Name of this fissure is pterygomaxillary fissure. Name of this fissure is pterygomaxillary fissure between maxilla and lateral pterygoid plate. Now, Several important structures, foramens, are coming here in the roof portion of infratemporal fossa. This infratemporal fossa is deep, it is very deep at the base of the skull, it will extend till the base of the skull. And these foramen, which I am passing the probe, foramen oval, foramen spinosum, once again foramen oval, then foramen spinosum, they are present in roof portion of infratemporal fossa. These will be taken in detail during the study of norma basalis. So this much is the limit of infratemporal fossa. What does infratemporal fossa contain? This infratemporal fossa contains muscles of mastication, masticatory muscles. Now we go back. Once we go back, here we pass to the mandibular fossa. In the mandibular fossa, head of the mandible will articulate and form temporomandibular joint, or in short it is called TM joint. The mandibular fossa is formed by squamous portion of temporal bone, Anteriorly, there will be this articular tubercle. Posteriorly, there will be this post-glenoid tubercle. And supramastoid crest, the posteriormost root of the zygoma, which is extending above the mandibular fossa. It will extend above the external acoustic meatus also. So we come to external acoustic meatus. The boundaries of external acoustic meatus will be, if you see very clearly, anteriorly and inferiorly. Anteriorly and inferiorly, this plate. Beautifully you are able to appreciate this plate. So this plate will form anterior and inferior boundary right over here, till over here. And this is called tympanic plate of temporal bone. So the boundary of external acoustic meatus, anteriorly and inferiorly, will be tympanic plate of temporal bone. Posteriorly, this will be completed by squamous portion of temporal bone, Superiorly, supramastoid crest. This line which I have done is supramastoid crest. Posterior superiorly, there is an important segment which is present here. Now posterior superiorly, there will be a triangle. If I show you this triangle, if I mark this triangle, it will go like this. Superiorly, the triangle is formed by supramastoid crest. It is extended posteriorly. Then anteroinferiorly, the triangular boundary will be this. This is the posterior wall of external acoustic meatus. This is the external acoustic meatus, posterior wall. So anteroinferiorly, this triangle is formed by posterior wall of external acoustic meatus. And posteriorly, a vertical tangent. If you pass a vertical tangent like this, this is a vertical tangent. It is a vertical imaginary tangent which is passing from supramastoid crest and will merge with the posterior boundary of external acoustic meatus. So therefore the triangle which is created over here is called supramietal triangle. Once again I repeat, supramietal triangle, M-E-A-T-A-L. And there is a projection within the supramietal triangle. Sometimes that spinous projection is present. It is called supramietal spine. Sometimes it is present, supramietal spine. So supramietal triangle is present posterior superior to external acoustic meatus. How the triangle is formed, which I have already discussed with you. Then we come to this part, just behind external acoustic meatus. This is the tongue-shaped projection which is called mastoid process. This mastoid process, tongue-shaped projection, will develop after second year of birth. And this mastoid process, which is a part of temporal bone, will have apex. This will form the base, and there will be several attachments on mastoid process. And those attachments will be, if you see here, the deeper structure, the deeper part with the pen I have marked, this will form the mastoid notch. A notch-like structure you are able to appreciate very clearly. This is a notch-like structure. Even on this side, this is the notch-like structure. This is the notch-like structure. So therefore, this notch here, mastoid notch, even this notch here, mastoid notch on both the sides, there will be attachment of posterior belly of digastric muscle. Posterior belly of digastric muscle is attached here. Similarly, There will be attachment from this mastoid process, from the apex till the base. Yesterday, we had already discussed this. There will be attachment of three muscles from anterior to posterior. Sternocleidomastoid number 1, number 2, splenius capitis number 3, longissimus capitis. These three muscles are attached from anterior to posterior, right from apex of mastoid process till the base of mastoid process, and it will continue on the nuchal line. Which muscle? Sternocleidomastoid. Muscle number 2, splenius capitis. Muscle number 3, longissimus capitis. Then there is presence of one foramen here, which was known as mastoid foramen. What structures will pass through mastoid foramen? Yesterday I had discussed the emissary vein connecting the sigmoid sinus inside with the posterior auricular veins present outside. And there will be presence of meningeal branch of occipital artery also. Meningeal branch of occipital artery will pass through this mastoid foramen. This much is about mastoid process. One more structure which is present here between tympanic plate and mastoid process. This is tympanomastoid fissure. This is tympanomastoid fissure. On this skull now, change of skull. Here, mastoid process, tympanomastoid fissure. Here also tympanomastoid fissure, mastoid notch, mastoid notch. Here you are able to appreciate, see here, the supramietal triangle very clearly. Here also, on this side, you are able to appreciate supramietal triangle very clearly. External acoustic meatus, mandibular fossa. Here you are able to appreciate this post-glenoid tubercle. This is the articular tubercle. This is the tympanic plate. Again here, tympanic plate. Then here you are able to appreciate post-glenoid tubercle. This is the articular tubercle. External acoustic meatus. And now we come to tympanomastoid fissure. Change of skull. Once again, tympanomastoid fissure. This much is tympanomastoid fissure between mastoid process and tympanic plate. Structure which will pass outside. The structure which will pass will be the auricular branch of vagus nerve. Structure passing through this tympanomastoid fissure, this much is tympanomastoid fissure. The structure which will pass outside will be auricular branch of vagus nerve. Then we come to this styloid process here.